everyone. I'm Ronny Courtens, and I have been working in the film and television industry for nearly 40 years now. And these are some of the companies I've worked with in that period, either as an editor, a producer, or a post-production manager. Actually, I learned to work with every major NLE on a professional level, and I also started using Final Cut Pro 10 from day one. Now, the first real job we did with Final Cut Pro 10 was actually in 2012 at the Paralympic Games in London. This is a screenshot from an updated library, but we were still working on 10.05 then, which still had the events and projects separated. But I was already so impressed with how this totally new NLE performed in high-end broadcast operations that I started calling all my friends over Europe to ask, are you using Final Cut Pro 10? Are you considering it? Are you looking into it? And one thing that I noticed was that at that time, there was so much misunderstanding and a lot of misinformation published about Final Cut Pro 10, especially from people who had never worked with it. So I decided that I would start helping people get a better understanding of how Final Cut Pro 10 worked. And I started working together with Peter Wiggins from FCP.co, which is one of the most popular Final Cut Pro 10 sites. And I started to giving advice, workflow tips, also published articles about people in Europe using Final Cut Pro 10. I also contributed to the organization of special events around Final Cut Pro 10, the Final Cut Pro 10 tours, and people started to ask me questions of how can I integrate Final Cut Pro 10 in my production, in my existing infrastructure. And over the years, I got involved in some of the major Final Cut Pro 10 installs in Europe. Now, this has given me a fairly good idea about how many people are using Final Cut Pro 10 in Europe and on what level they are using it. And actually, I can say that, especially in the last years, Final Cut Pro 10 has become quite popular. Actually, if I had done this presentation 4 years ago, I probably would have been able to fill 5 minutes. Today, it's impossible to make a resume of everyone who uses Final Cut Pro 10 in Europe, even in a couple of hours. So I'll have to restrict myself for this 20-minute presentation, and I've decided to concentrate on film and television work, but we'll also touch other subjects. Now, let's start with fiction. We all know that some major Hollywood studio films have been cut with Final Cut Pro 10, but equally important to know is that lots of independent filmmakers, also in Europe, are turning to Final Cut Pro 10 for their productions. And let's start in Spain, which is a major player in the global movie production market. The Spanish film Loriac, Flowers, received many raving reviews around the world, and it was the official Spanish submission for the 2016 Oscars in the foreign language category. The film was shot on RED, Epic, at 5K, and edited in Final Cut Pro 10 on the 2009 Mac Pro, a iMac, and a MacBook Pro. Actually, they started editing on the first day of shooting, and they worked throughout the shoot, which lasted around 6 weeks. And 1 week after the last day of the shoot, they were able to show the first assembly of the movie to the directors, which is quite impressive, such a short time. The editor, Raul Lopez Romero, he used to work on Media Composer, Premiere Pro, and Final Cut 7, and he sees many advantages in using Final Cut Pro 10, especially because of the simplicity of executing edits on the timeline, the magnetic timeline. He says, it's astonishing to see how a director can turn up, just sit in front of the computer, and make changes to the edit without actually throwing everything out of sync. And we stay in Spain with another award-winning feature. El Hombre de las Mil Caras, or Smoke and Mirrors, is a two-hour drama thriller based on a true story of a former agent of the Spanish Secret Service who faked his own death after a financial scandal. Now, Alberto Rodriguez directed the movie, and he's one of Spain's prominent movie directors. And it was edited in Final Cut Pro 10 by Jose M.G. Moyano. So you see, they took the Arri Alexa RAW, they went to DaVinci Resolve for it, and they exported QuickTime ProRes for the editing, and then went back to the original media. The team shot over 80 hours of Arri footage in 62 shooting days, 90 different locations in Europe and Asia. And every day they did made progress proxy files from the footage, uploaded it via Google Drive to the editorial in Spain, who could already start prepping the footage while they were waiting for the high-resolution media. And this also allowed them to give feedback to the director who was in another country while the shoot was still going on. So the movie won the Silver Shell for Best Actor at the San Sebastian Film Festival. It got 11 nominations for the 2017 Goya Awards, that's like the Spanish Oscars, and 10 nominations for the 2017 Ferrer's Awards. It was also screened in London at the National Film Festival. Manuel Terceño, who was the second editor on the movie, was so happy with how things had progressed with Final Cut Pro 10 that he decided to use Final Cut Pro 10 on his next project, which was the television movie La Llum d'Elna. Now, La Llum d'Elna, or The Light of Hope, is directed by Silvia Quer, and she has worked on many scripted television productions in Spain. The film was shot with Arri Alexis in Progress 44444XQ and edited natively in Final Cut Pro 10. Now, Manuel told us that the director, Silvia, she had never seen Final Cut Pro 10 before, but she quickly became familiar with it, and actually, she told him that after having seen it at work, she liked it a lot. She was particularly pleased with one feature, which is auditions. The fact that you can have multiple alternate shots into one clip on the timeline, and you can switch between the shots with just a click of a button, which is a powerful feature, especially when you have lots of alternate takes to view. Today, Manuel is working on another high-profile production in Spain. It's a primetime television series consisting of 6 episodes of 50 minutes called La Peste, or The Plague. Now, they are editing with 2 editors and 1 assistant editor, collaborating in Final Cut Pro 10 on a 120-terabyte LumaForge tower. And from Spain, let's go to the upper north, to Finland. There's Benjamin Mercer. Benjamin is an award-winning Finnish-English film editor with almost 2 decades of work for numerous directors and production companies. In 2015, he worked on Rebellion. It's a prestigious television series, a $20 million budget, and a primetime production for Irish national broadcaster RTE1, the Sundance Channel, and Netflix. Right after Rebellion, he started working on The Unknown Soldier. That's a major European movie about a Finnish rifle company during World War II. Now look at these shooting figures, it's quite impressive. 80 days of shooting, production team of 120 people, and so on. And Ben says he knows every NLE, and he says that he particularly likes to use Final Cut Pro 10 on this scale of movies because of the organizational features that allow him to see the forest to the trees with all these kinds of media. From Finland, we go to Germany. Knut Hake is an Emmy Award winning, a famous editor in Germany, who has got a large number of feature films and primetime television exclusively on Final Cut Pro 10. Actually, one of the first reasons I met Kurt was when he was working on Danny Lewinsky. Now, that's a TV comedy. It got gigantic viewer ratings and it won industry awards for best series and best comedy. It has become one of the most successful programs for German broadcaster SAT1. Knut edited the first 2 seasons of Danny Lewinsky and Final Cut Pro 7, and he decided to move over to Final Cut Pro 10 because he found that the speed and the new capabilities of Final Cut Pro 10 offered him a straighter path to the story. Since Danny Lewinsky, Knut has been using Final Cut Pro 10 to edit a large number of television movies. He also edited Zara, which is a 45-minute episode television series for primetime German television. And at this moment, he is starting to work on new episodes for Tatort. Tatort is a German police television series that has been running continuously since 1970. With 30 feature-length episodes per year. So you can imagine, Knut is a very busy man at the moment. And to end our little overview of scripted content, let's move over to Russia. It's the first time we get a Russian editor coming to FCPX World. Nikolai Pigarev is a producer, a colorist, a film director, and editor. And he lives and works between Moscow, Los Angeles, and London. He's a vivid fan of Final Cut Pro 10, and he has been editing all of his projects on it. Music videos, TV series, feature films, etc. Now, currently, he's working on a television drama consisting of 16 episodes, and it's called Lapsy, for which he did everything from edit to color and finish. We have invited Nikolai to talk about his production in more detail later this afternoon. So, from fiction to factual. Factual television productions are extremely popular these days, and some major production companies like Metronome Productions in Denmark, they're part of the international Endemol Shine group, have been switching to Final Cut Pro 10 for their conceptual and reality television work. I saw Ryan this morning, he said we have 60 seats of Final Cut Pro 10 now. In such productions, a lot of people work together on a program. Not only the hardcore editors, but also journalists, post-producers, who pre-cut the stories before sending them to the hardcore editors. So they developed effective collaboration workflows with Final Cut Pro 10 to allow for this. And the management of Metronome found out that Final Cut Pro 10 allowed them to deliver their high-quality content in a more cost-efficient way than ever before. Staying in Denmark and going over to STV, STV is another major television production company. In Denmark, until recently, all of their productions were cut on Avid. Now, for Klassen, their new primetime television series for children, the producer decided to go with Final Cut Pro 10. So they had to produce 69 10-minute episodes at the rate of 5 episodes per week. They needed 6 editors to work on that program simultaneously. Unfortunately, the Avid Nexus they had could not handle the Final Cut Pro 10 libraries, and so they went for a new collaborative workflow with Jellyfish Mobile to output this rhythm of episodes per week. Their program was a hit. The viewer ratings were spectacular, both for television and also for the spin-offs they made for the online for YouTube. We're in Holland. Blazowski is a Warner television division, uses Final Cut Pro 10 to edit some of the most popular factual and entertainment programs in Holland. They have 10 edit suites connected to a 100 terabyte LumaForge share station. And in Germany, the production company Schnittchen exclusively uses Final Cut Pro 10 to produce primetime TV content for the major German broadcasters, with 8 Final Cut Pro 10 edit suites running on 2013 Mac Pros with ultra-wide screens. Back to Spain, we're with David Lopez. And David edits one of the most popular factual shows of Spanish television. It's edited in Final Cut Pro 10, and he does the post-production management and the editing with a whole team of editors. Every week, they have to output a new program, and that's, I think, a 50-minute or an hour program. So it's a very hectic workflow they have. And this new show is hosted by Jordi Evole. It airs on Sunday evening, and the show was an immediate hit. Now, for the people who like to see timelines, that's one. We're in Finland again. This is the timeline of Siskon Petty. It's a factual comedy. Actually, it's a kind of Smack the Pony comedy. And this is Jesse Jokela from Finland during the FCPX tour in Tampere, explaining his edit workflows with Final Cut Pro 10 on this very popular comedy series for Finnish television. It won Comedy and Sketch Program Awards in 14 and 15 and nominated for Best Comedy Show at the Rose Door Awards in 2016. Jesse also showed his workflows on Armand and the Last Crusade, which is a very popular documentary series for Channel 4 in Finland. And again, you see how Final Cut Pro 10 handles all these layers of green key and handles lots of media and long timelines without any problems. Now, while we're talking about documentaries in Amsterdam, yes, Amsterdam-based EMS Films, they're working on The Wild City, De Wilde Stad. Actually, it's a documentary, a feature-length documentary about wild animals living in the city of Amsterdam. We'll be right back. They shot over 1,500 hours of footage, which they edit, and that was, some of them was red 5K, which they edit natively in Final Cut Pretend, so without transcoding or anything, and they edit it in a 2K timeline, because this documentary is for theatrical distribution for the cinema. And they also use a LumaForge tower because they work with five editors at the same time on that program. And it's connected to five Final Cut Pretend stations. Producer Mark Verkerk is here. Hello, Mark. And he will come to tell us all about this unique production. Now, besides being a popular tool for fiction and factual production, the speed and the stability of Final Cut Pretend make it an ideal solution for broadcast, news, sports, and events programming. That's the world I live in. The BBC has adopted Final Cut Pretend for sports and news, and they love it. Look at that tweet. So the people who train the editors say that all of them have expressed their surprise at how fast and versatile editing in Final Cut Pretend is. And many editors and producers within the BBC are actually now having a second look at Final Cut Pretend for other types of productions. As you can see there, Ollie says, another fun day teaching Final Cut Pretend, the BBC love it. Shame there's still so much misinformation about it out there. But also TF1, which is one of the largest French broadcasters, I've worked with them, they have intensively tested different NLEs to set up a new editing pipeline for their on-location news. So the last two programs that remained were Premier CC and Final Cut Pretend. They say both of these are excellent applications, but they went with Final Cut Pretend. And in Eastern Europe, there is TVN24. TVN24 is one of the largest broadcast operations in Eastern Europe. They exclusively use Final Cut Pretend, and their counterpart, the Polish National Television, is also Final Cut Pretend. They use it for sports and news, just like TV2 in Norway. Final Cut Pretend is being used in every aspect of broadcast production today, and that's for editing sports programs against fierce deadlines, such as the Tour de France, or the Le Mans 24 hours endurance races. They just finished the latest show. I was in contact with Sacha. He couldn't come over, but it's amazing what they do with Final Cut Pretend. And let's move over to post-production. Swiss national broadcaster RTS uses Final Cut Pretend for its entire post-production. They manage no less than 800 hours of content each year with Final Cut Pretend. They handle complex multicam timelines in native resolution, complex graphics and effects in combination with motion, and their programs are delivered for on-air playout straight from the post-production room. When you do a broadcast operation, you have to integrate with existing systems. Their editing and audio suites are connected over fiber channel to a 160 terabyte LumaForge share station, which is fully integrated with their existing networks and their custom-built media asset management. This is to prove that Final Cut Pretend can perfectly integrate with traditional structures in broadcast. Dutch broadcaster EO, Evangelische Omroep, has done the same. Actually, they have integrated the famous digital asset manager Cantemo Portal with Final Cut Pretend to streamline their asset management. And let's not forget the online news. In the next presentation, Christian Pettersen, technical operations manager at VG, which is a division of the International Shipset Media Group, will explain how Final Cut Pretend has played a dominant role in their transition from being Norway's biggest newspaper to also becoming a successful broadcaster with in-house production of news, sports, documentary, episodics, and a 24/7 news channel, and everything is edited in Final Cut Pretend. Now, that wraps it up for fiction, for factual, and for broadcast, but as we all know, Final Cut Pretend is also very as a favorite NLE for commercials, music videos, and corporate. This is a very interesting one. Now, James Tonkin in the UK is one of the leading music directors. He has traveled around the globe capturing the biggest names in the music industry, the Rolling Stones, Robbie Williams, AC/DC, U2, Beyoncé, Coldplay, Sinead O'Connor, you name them. And he exclusively uses Final Cut Pretend to create all these stunning images. They also use Logic Pro X. They have a high-end audio suite based on Logic Pro X to create their soundscapes for their videos. All of their suites are connected to a powerful 100 terabyte LumaForge rack with 40 gigabit Ethernet speed. Final Crypto 10 is hot in corporate, and even the high-end corporate, like with Tech TV. They use Final Crypto 10 to create amazing award-winning visuals for high-profile corporate clients. Final Crypto 10 allows them to actually produce cinematic-looking content, and I see we still have some time, so I will show you a little video. All their work is done exclusively with Motion and Final Crypto 10. I hope this little overview has given you a general idea of how Final Crypto 10 is being used by award-winning directors, editors, and producers in Europe. It can easily handle heavy post-production and collaboration workflows, and it perfectly integrates with other broadcast systems and operations. I think in only 6 years' time, this totally new application is already on par with other NLEs that have had development cycles of 20 years and more. And in my opinion, the best is yet to come. Thank you for your attention.